And joining us now in Washington, D.C., Sandra Day O'Connor, retired U.S. Supreme Court Justice. Justice O'Connor, it's a pleasure to be talking to you today. Thank you for joining me.
I'm glad it worked out. Thank you.
Well, I know it's been some years since you stepped down from the bench of the Supreme Court in the United States.
Well, not too long. It doesn't seem too long to me.
2005, if I've got the year correct.
Yes.
Well, I know you, let me put it to you this way. I know you've been very busy in the intervening years. Yes. And one of the things you've been working on is the iCivics project and civic education in the U.S., and that's what we want to speak with you about today.
Good.
So I want to just step back, though. Around the time that you stepped down from the bench, there were some people, I think conservative Republicans for the most part, attacking the independence of the courts in the U.S. What was your reaction at the time?
Well, there was criticism from all quarters, including from Republican circles, on courts in general. There seemed to me that there was an increasing number of complaints about the courts and a lack of understanding about judicial independence, whatever that is. And I think that much of that came, was a product of ignorance of by the public generally about the role of the courts.
What do you mean by that?
Well, for instance, there was a survey conducted by the Annenberg Public Policy Center, and it tells us that at that time, 75% of Americans did not really know the difference between a judge and a legislator. And half the people surveyed thought it was important to be able to impeach a judge just for making a decision that was unpopular with the public. And more than two-thirds of Americans at that time could name at least one judge on that television program, American Idol, but not, they couldn't name the Chief Justice of the United States. And that kind of thing makes it clear why political attacks or criticism of judges and courts was on the rise. And I think we understand that that was the setting and probably still is to a great extent.
Were you surprised when you saw those kinds of statistics?
Yes, it was. I was aware in general that there was a lack of understanding, but those statistics brought it too close to home for me.
And that was the reason that then you decided to devote much of your time to educating young people.
Well, yes, and I also realized that that lack of knowledge extended beyond just the judicial branch of government. As you know, in the United States as well as in Canada, we have three branches of government. And in the U.S., at least, we think that most young people should understand our Bill of Rights. And it set out the basic rights of all citizens of the United States. And a majority of the students who were being interviewed could not name a single activity that was part of civic life, part of the basic concept of the Bill of Rights. I mean, we couldn't get any information from them at all. And I mean, these young people are the coming generation of voters, of our community leaders, of our citizens. And understanding the role of citizens in our form of government in the United States as well as in Canada is really essential to the preservation of democracy in both of our countries. And if we don't understand the concept of the obligation and rights of citizens, what do we expect is going to happen? It isn't going to be quite what we want,
well,
I think.
Well, tell me this, because I want to go back to your days in El Paso, Texas, growing up, going to school as a child. During that time, I mean, was the situation vastly different? Were you learning in school about the branches of government and about civics?
Yes, I grew up on a ranch in a very remote place in Arizona and New Mexico. There weren't any schools within striking distance, so my parents sent me off to El Paso, Texas, where I stayed with my maternal grandparents and went to school in El Paso. And we learned a lot about our government in school. We learned about particularly government and civics and the history of Texas. And to be honest, I heard so much about Stephen Austin and Sam Houston, Texas heroes, that it would be fine with me if I didn't have to hear any more about them these days.
But the times, they are changing. Things are quite different nowadays.
Yes. Well, they're different and they're not different. We still have young people growing up who are going to be citizens and voters and in charge of us all. And I'm not sure that young people today know any more than we did when I was a youngster in El Paso.
You know, back in 2007, you held a conference at Georgetown Law School, and you brought together a variety of professionals to talk about civics education. What kind of conclusions did this group come to regarding how engaged young people are with civic life?
Well, we didn't have the statistics that we now have, but all of us were aware that young people in general have very little contact as youngsters with our government, and in ways to show these young people what their role is going to be as citizens. I mean, most of the schools in those days did try to teach civics, and we didn't have public schools in our country when our nation was formed, when we adopted our Constitution. We didn't have public schools. And young people learned in different ways, usually by private teaching, and some went off to some kind of schools, but there wasn't an organized program to teach civics. And it was in the 1820s or thereabouts that there was a movement in the United States to get public schools, to get education for young people. And the motivation behind that was to try to teach these young people the nature of our government so that they would understand their role as it was going to be as citizens of our country and how they could be involved. And so I think that was the goal. And I went on from high school in El Paso to Stanford University in California. And I must say, I didn't know a lot about government myself and citizens' involvement, but I heard at Stanford that there was a law school professor there who gave a few undergraduate classes at Stanford, and that he was an inspiring professor. Because of that advice, I signed up for one of his classes at Stanford, and he was very inspiring. Growing up on the ranch, as I did, in a remote area, I didn't know lawyers. They weren't part of my environment at all. And my parents' friends tended to be people in the cattle business, not lawyers. Mm-hmm. And so I had a lot to learn. And I valued the class that I had from that professor. And I think it was because of him, probably, that I eventually applied for admission to law school at Stanford.
Well, you are now, you know, the tables are turned a little bit because now you're teaching students about civics through your program called iCivics. So tell me what iCivics is about.
iCivics is an attempt to teach middle school students primarily. That's grades 5 through 9, middle school students. They are the most receptive. They're marvelous. I don't know if you've been around young people a lot, but at that age, the hormones haven't totally kicked in, so they're not just interested in kids of the opposite sex. They're still happy to be learning. They like to learn, and they like school, and they like learning things. So I have found that that's a great age to teach young people almost anything. So that was our target with iCivics, to tell you the truth.
Tell me about
here's the other thing that we were very conscious of. Young people that age and on even older spend on an average 40 hours a week in front of some kind of TV screen. That is a huge amount of time. And so what it seemed to me, at least, and the people I was talking to, is that if you're going to try an education program, it probably ought to be something that could be used, found on a website, and you could dial up on a computer and watch a screen and learn the things that we hope to teach. We thought that was the best way to get people educated, and then to make it fun. And to do that, you had to have games. And what we did as a start was get a group of teacher advisors. And we have the most wonderful group of teachers that we assembled, mostly from the southwest of the United States, but experienced teachers who could tell us if we were going to teach civics in middle school at that age, what specifically would we have to cover? What concepts should be in there? And with that advice and knowledge, we then tried to develop games that the young people could play, that we could put on the website, that they could dial up and play, and in the process, learn while they were having a good time playing games. Now, there are a few firms in the United States, and I'm sure in Canada as well, whose job it is to develop games that can be used on a website that have the effect of teaching things. And so that's how we made progress.
Well, I want to talk to you.
I think it was a good idea.
I want to talk to you about one of the games specifically, but before I do that, I want to ask you, where did the I in iCivics, what's that all about?
Well, because we have iPad and iPod and iEverything, little I, don't know where that came from, but we thought iCivics made sense.
Fair enough, good point. Okay, I want to talk about, just as an example, one of the games. One is called Executive Command, and it shows the user what it's like to be president for a day. So broadly speaking, what's a game like that? What's the student supposed to learn from something like that? What's it supposed to teach them?
Well, what we hope it teaches is a general view of the kinds of things that a president is faced with day in and day out in terms of deciding things. I don't think most of us, much less our young people, know what goes on in the president's office day in and day out. What kinds of decisions is he supposed to reach? What is he doing? What is he saying? What is he directing from that office? And so we tried to encompass some of that in the game so that a young person playing the role of president could experience some of the issues that that president would have to face day in and day out.
What are the reactions from the students that have played this and you've talked with? What have they been saying to you?
Well, they like it. They have fun. I mean, young people are used to playing games, you know. They kind of like that. And they're very accustomed to turning on a TV screen and doing something on the internet, and particularly if it's interactive. So they like it. It lets them in on the actual situation. They can pretend to be a president and have to decide certain things in the office.
You know, there are those that would say that, yes, this is fun and it's an added tool for young people to learn from, but, you know, civics really belongs in a more traditional setting, not in a video game sort of setting, interactive game. So is there evidence to say that students are actually learning from these games?
Oh, indeed there is. We've had several studies done by groups who make it their business to study the progress of students and how much they've learned in one way or another. And we've had young people who've been exposed to iCivics games then tested, and they just have learned incredible amounts. It is extremely effective. It's just remarkable. In fact, one of the recent studies was done at Baylor University in Texas. And they have an education department, and they made a major study of this and to see how effective it is. And the results were overwhelmingly positive. It's just remarkable how much students learn from this process that happens to be fun while they're doing it.
We know in your country, and similarly in ours for that matter, that it's, you know, not just children that might not know these kinds of things about civic education.
Oh, the adults are just about as bad. You're right. It's the young people are a reflection of what their parents know, and it isn't that much. None of us are as well informed as we should be about what the different branches of our government are doing.
So let me ask you this then. This approach, is geared towards children. How do you engage adults on these kinds of matters?
Through the children, I guess. Most adults are interested in what their children are learning. I always was, as a parent of young people, and I like to kind of follow along and see what they're learning. If they're using a certain textbook, I like to have a look at it and see what's in there. And if they're not using a textbook, as might be the case with an online class on a computer, then I would be interested as a parent in knowing what it is the young people are learning. So I think that's why there is an interest there and why it's important for the young people as well as their parents to have a concept of what's being taught.
The changing demographics in the United States is something, you know, we hear a lot about on many different levels here in Canada. And I'm wondering how, new immigration to your country has affected how civics is taught in your schools.
Well, if you are admitting to your country large numbers of people from elsewhere in the world, some of whom don't even speak English language very well, and people who have had no training at all in schools in the United States to have an opportunity to learn about the system of government, you have a big job on your hands to teach immigrants, to teach newcomers to the country who are going to live here, to teach them how government works. Now, to become a citizen in the United States, and I assume it's similar in Canada, the prospective citizen has to take some tests about how the American system of government works. They're expected to know and understand a lot of things, more even than a grade schooler would in the United States. So it's not like this is a new concept. People are expected to know some of these things.
I want to talk a little bit about a new bill that was introduced in the House of Representatives in the U.S. last year. It's a bipartisan bill, and it's called the Sandra Day O'Connor Civic Learning Act. That's a pretty good title.
Well, that's pretty exciting, isn't it?
Yeah.
I don't know what's happened to it, but it's based on what's going on with the iCivics program. And perhaps it was an effort by the sponsors to perhaps generate overall support throughout the country for this notion of effectively educating young people about how our government works.
It suggests to me, though, that your representatives, your government seems to think that your idea that, well, not your idea, but your push to better educate young people is a good one.
Yes.
So I'm wondering if this bill does pass,
yes,
will it, further the success of things like iCivics?
I'm sure it would. It would encourage and bring more recognition in a public fashion throughout the United States to school administrators and to school boards about the availability of opportunities to better educate young people about our system of government. So it can't hurt, and I think it could help a lot.
Well, there you go. We'll have to see where it goes. You said you're not sure
Yes.
where it stands right now. We'll keep an eye on that.
No,
one.
No, I'm not. No.
I do want to talk to you about one other thing, and that, of course, is you being the first woman appointed to the U.S. Supreme Court and where we are these days in terms of women's representation on various benches. So I just want to read a short quote to you. Just have a listen to this. This comes from the Women's Law Center, the U.S. National Women's Law Center report, and it was from May of earlier this year. Over the past three decades, an increasing number of women have joined the legal profession. For 25 years, approximately 45% of law students have been women. In the last decade, women's representation has approached 50%. But the number of women in the federal judiciary has largely stagnated. 51 of the 166 active judges currently sitting on the 13 federal courts of appeal are female. That's about 31%. When broken down by circuit, women's representation on several of these individual courts is even lower than on the courts of appeal overall. Justice O'Connor, why are we still not seeing enough or more women in the U.S. federal judiciary?
It's a slow process to select judges. the federal judiciary is not large. As you know, I'm sure it's the same in Canada. It's a small percentage of the overall number of judges. In the United States, the bulk of cases are decided in state courts. And in a large number of state courts, judges are elected, not appointed. And so we have a different process involved in selection of judges in many of the states in the United States. The federal court system is much smaller overall in numbers, but the federal courts play a very important role in our country, and we care about the composition there. And when I was asked to serve on the Supreme Court and nominated by then President Ronald Reagan, it was the year 1981. At that time, there had never been a woman on the United States Supreme Court from the beginning of our country, not one. So that absence was notable. That sets kind of an example from the top down. And so President Reagan's decision to put a woman, it's not because it was me, but to put a woman on the Supreme Court was very significant for our country. I think it had repercussions in other countries as well. Canada's response was a little more prompt than ours. It was not long at all before Canada had at least three women on the Canadian Supreme Court. And it took us much longer. We have three women on there now, but it took a while.
But you were the first, and I'm wondering, were you always aware that you were setting such a huge example for women to look up to and to follow?
Well, it was clear to me that being the first and for some years only woman on the U.S. Supreme Court made me highly visible in our country and probably beyond our borders as well. In that capacity, you're aware that you probably ought to try to do a pretty good job if you're going to set a good example.
I think there are many people who would agree that you did quite a good job.
Thank you.
You have not stopped working. You're very busy and very active. You've written a children's book. You're involved in the civic engagement.
Two children's books. And two adult books, and I have another one coming out in February.
Well, there you go, because that was my question. What are we going to see next from Justice O'Connor? So it's a book coming out.
Well, you're going to see another book from me come February.
Another book, and what's it about?
Well, it's about the court, basically. But it has some interesting stories in it. So I hope it will be something of interest to general readers.
Well, we appreciate your time, Justice O'Connor. Thank you very much for joining us today, and do take care.
Thank you. And let me just say, while I have you, that the Canadian Supreme Court has been an inspiration beyond Canada's borders. You've had a wonderful woman Chief Justice for a number of years. She's just done a great job. You have a number of women on the Canadian Supreme Court, and it has been an inspiration to us.
Well, on behalf of all the women in Canada, we know that we appreciate the women on our bench, and we thank you for also setting an example for all these years. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.